go ahead and get this meeting underway, and we will begin with our conflict of interest statement. It is of the utmost importance to ensure that all university decisions are free from any real or perceived conflicts of interest. Therefore, please be mindful of all obligations with which you have been charged as a trustee of Wright State University, and take the steps you deem appropriate to perform your duties fairly and impartially. So we have a pretty big agenda again today. You know, I think we continue to make good progress. We obviously still have a long way to go, but why don't we just jump right into it? So I'll turn it over to you, Walt.
Thank you. I want to start by introducing one of our recent additions to the business and finance staff. As you know, we've been working on the organization, making some changes with the departure of some of the key staff. We brought John in on a temporary basis. We have hired Laura Sedor. Laura, would you stand up? Laura is the assistant controller, so she's in charge of accounting as well as payroll and many other things, and she has, if you recognize her, or the name, she was in internal audit for 3 years, and so that was an internal promotion that we were able to create for her. So we're happy to really have her on board. She was instrumental in helping us prepare the financial report this year and get through the audit, and so she just dove right in. So welcome, Laura. In front of you, there is, and I don't really need to go through this, but we gave everybody a copy of our meeting schedule for the year and what we're anticipating being on the agenda for every month. This can change, but I wanted to give folks some kind of a plan for the year and some advance notice about what might be coming up. So we'll be modifying that throughout the year, but I would just point out, if you look at next month, about halfway down the November meeting, we have a very long agenda in November. But a lot of things come together right at this time of the year. The only other thing I would report is we completed the audit, the external audit with BKD, and we submitted the audit and the financial report to the state on time. Last year we were late, but we got it submitted to the state on time, and we will be presenting to that will be part of what we're presenting to the committee next month. So thank you.
John?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, everybody. So we're gonna go through our financial status reports. The first thing in your list or your packet would be the variance explanations. And behind that, report number one is where I will start, which is the unrestricted funds, including auxiliaries report. Again, going down the left-hand columns, we have what happened last year. So last year, year-end, still reporting the $10 million surplus. Year-to-date, for fiscal 18, the surplus revenue over expense was $45 million, which is almost exactly where we are through September this year, if you look at revenue minus expense going down the middle columns. So what I'd like to do is spend the first part of this discussion going through the center section of that report, where we've estimated the budget to date, we've given you the actual to date and the variance. My initial pass through this was to try and explain variances of $500,000 or more and 10% variance. As I went through it, it seemed like there might need to be a little bit more explanation, so I'm just going to go through the categories and make comments. First of all, in tuition and fee revenue, a little unusual situation in my experience where our tuition and fees actually went down by about $100,000. That's because of the drop adds that occur in September, and so we had more credit hours dropped than added. And so there was a net refund to the students. There was also a change this year where we moved the cancellation for non-payment out of September into August, so that was in last month's results. But it does affect the budget number for this year, because last year it was in the September numbers and the way the monthly or the year-to-date budgets are calculated. You'll see that effect more pronounced when we get to the month-only report, report number three.
I have a question.
How do you attribute those that explanation to refunds? What, is there an explanation for why students are dropping so much, or do you see?
No, you know, I don't really have an explanation.
I know we don't give a reason when we drop, but.
Yeah, and I guess the thing that I found in researching this was that it's a historical trend here. That's kind of the way it goes. As students level out their workload or what have you for the semester, there tends to be more credit hours dropped versus added back.
Okay.
So maybe, I don't know, maybe signing up for more courses than you really want to.
Yeah, I can understand that.
So I'm just going to touch on a couple of these other categories. Grant and contract, that's straight federal cost reimbursement grants, timing a little bit higher this year than in the past. Sales and services has to do with revenue for the Lake Campus residence halls. That's a pass-through, so that will actually disappear out of the accounting records next time. Investment income, I noted in my report, that's because we had an unrealized gain in one of our private equity funds, so it's a mark-to-market that occurred as of the end of June. You can't really spend that, but it's recognized as revenue. It could just as easily go away at the end of the next quarter if there's a loss. The gifts, contributions, and other revenue mixed in there is the credit card rebate for the P cards that we use. And so, again, that might be a timing issue, or it could just be the fact that it's a little higher. It's not a significant variance. Moving on to expenses, compensation, we would attribute the small savings to basically salary savings year to date for 3 months. The other one that I did note, which is somewhat of an embarrassment for me as a controller, supplies being under budget by so much is because the P-card charges didn't get posted on time. And so that will come back in the next month.
And so that'll be roughly $600,000 or?
About $480,000 was that amount out of the $600,000. The information and communications line is a relatively small line, so any change there can cause a large percentage. My only comment here is what we're seeing is that there are certain things that we do that are chargebacks to departments. And I've given one example in my write-up, but departments are being very frugal in what they're doing, and there's not a lot of chargebacks going on anymore. So, or I should say there's less than there was before. So one example might be, or is, that departments are turning off telephone lines. And so you still have to maintain the telephone system, but departments aren't paying for it. And it doesn't mean that IT will not be on budget, because they will be on budget. I've talked to Craig about that. But we're seeing this in other areas like facilities and in copiers, where wherever there's a chargeback, the usage just drops.
So it looks like on balance, our revenue is down roughly $5.5 million relative to the same period last year. On a year-to-date basis, from 131 to 125, and our expenses are down roughly $6 million when we adjust for the fact that we'll have the P card charges coming back through.
Right. But likewise, the budget on revenue was down over last year, intentionally.
Yeah. To right. No. I understand. Yeah, you're right on, very close to budget for total revenue. Do you know, so we're down roughly $5.5 million from the 131, so call it 4%. Do you know what this decrease was in revenue in the same period the previous year? So in other words, are we declining at an accelerated pace or a more reduced rate?
No, I didn't look at that. We more looked at what did we budget down and are we keeping pace with where we expected to be?
Mm-hmm.
And I think the answer is we're down a little farther than we expected to be because we're still saying, same as last month, we're still saying we'll probably be down in tuition revenue, 2.4 million.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I guess the point that I'm trying to get to is the way that we get out of this challenge is by getting our revenue growing again.
Right.
And the question is, are we getting better or getting worse? Are we getting closer to zero or positive, or are we getting further away from it? So maybe we could talk about that in our next
meeting. So looking at the rate of change over those times.
Exactly. If we declined 7% last year and 4% this year, that's a step in the right direction, right? If we declined 2% last year and 4% this year, it's a step in the wrong direction.
Right.
That's what I'd like to understand.
Got it. Okay. So that pretty much wraps up my comments on this report. I mean, we haven't changed the annual projection at all from last month.
Okay. Any other questions from committee members? All right.
Then moving to the second report, which again shows the budget versus actual for 19, but it shows actual versus year end for 18. Kind of a way of comparing how are you doing this year versus where you actually ended up last year. And we seem to be tracking pretty well, which tells me again that the budget was right-sized. We have 45% of the revenues to budget, and last year you had 45% of revenues to actual year end. Expenses are slightly lower on pace versus last year. That could be because there are some central budgets that are just now being allocated that haven't been spent yet.
Mm-hmm. What budgets are those? Do you know?
So one would be our strategic initiatives that was recently allocated out for enrollment management purposes. So that was a large chunk of the budget. Another thing that I did was I'm holding back transfers to repair and renovation reserves. In the past, that was done in July, and that really ought to be done at year end when you actually know the status of an auxiliary. So that's a over $1 million variance.
When we look at the debt line, if you look at the debt line in the annual budget and you look at the debt line year to date, they're basically the same. So we've made all of our debt payments for the year.
Well,
how does that work?
We've transferred it out of the general fund to the plant fund in preparation to make those payments.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay, so they're already out of your budget.
Right.
Then if you want to talk about the last report, number three, which is the month only of September, I don't have any additional remarks other than to say, but on the tuition line, you can see what I was talking about earlier, where this year down $103,000, but September of 18 actual down 1.6. That's the movement of that cancellation process out of September back into August. And then the rest of the variances that I discussed on the first report would apply.
And does the health insurance, which kind of caught us a little bit last year, when it was different than what we'd expected it to be, is that in the compensation line?
Yes.
Are we seeing anything different or unusual in there?
Actually, the only thing that's unusual is that it hasn't gone up as much as we thought in terms of the medical claims.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty flat.
Okay. Okay. All right. Good.
Okay, moving on to contracts then?
Yep.
Cash reports, sorry, cash. given you a cover page and then two reports, one of which is a graph that we've added to. We've reworked this report slightly to pull working capital apart from restricted investments so that you can see what you really have to work with in terms of cash, which I call working capital. It does have that Star Ohio account in it, which is a quasi-investment that I consider it to be cash. We started the year $10 million higher than we
that
did.
That includes your private equity investment?
No, the private equity investments are in the middle section under restricted investments.
Okay.
Because you can't really spend those things.
Right. Okay, that's what I was asking.
Yeah. And then the other thing we did on the top section on the working capital was we added the day's cash on hand so that you can actually put into perspective, well, what does it mean to have $55 million or $69 million worth of cash? Well, that equates to 93 days worth of cash on hand.
Okay.
If you follow that all the way out to the end of the year in June, we expect that we'll have 56 days cash on hand at the end of June.
Yeah.
And that compares to 27 a year ago.
Great. And I think we said we wanted to get to 3 to 6 months cash on hand. So we're getting kind of to 2 months at the low point here.
And,
so
right,
moving in the right direction.
And to get to 90 days of cash, we need $67 million, which would be 25 over the 42 that's projected.
How do we get to 93 days of cash in August with only 40 million? Or no,
yeah,
I'm sorry, 69 million.
69.
Okay, I'm sorry, I was looking at the beginning balance.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you need 69 million. Okay, got it.
And so the rest of this is pretty self-explanatory in terms of what I've already written up. Interest earnings, 103,000 for the month. I think you're getting a good rate on the Star Ohio account at 2.2%.
Great.
None of us can get that in our, at least I can't get it in my funds. then again, the unrealized gains were recognized under the alternative investments as income. It's the mark to market. We've added the number of days. And then when you look at the graphs, which is the second report, we've given the standard cash balance that you've always seen, but then we've given you the day's cash on hand graph, and you can see that fiscal 19 is the black line, always above where we were in fiscal 18, and likewise 18 was above 17. So you can see that the progress that's been made over 3 years.
So John, the two real estate sales that we approved last Friday for about $2.3 million, that's not in here
it
yet.
Is not in
so
here.
That money, when those sales are closed, would drop into the
drop into here
into cash.
Yes. Yeah. Those hadn't been approved at the time.
Right. No. Right. I just.
So that's my report on
how much cash is that?
$2.3 million, give or take. Transaction cost, which I don't think.
So you're still going to have this $2.4 million shortfall in revenue. So what's the plan? What levers are we going to pull that we have to get started on to address the shortfall?
So what we've looked at is really two things that we're looking. The first is using some of the excess carry forward from last year. The second then is vacant positions. We believe that we'll have, I believe the number is about $250,000 a month generated from cash that we pull back from vacant positions. So between those two, we should be able to cover it. We plan to be able to.
Another way of asking that same question is, what's your level of confidence? You know, the budget called for a $3 million surplus at the end of this year, given the shortfall in revenue. What's your level of confidence that we'll hit that $3 million in surplus? Granted, it's 3 months into the quarter or the year, but
I'm fairly confident, I think. particularly if we use some of the carry forward from last year. And with the vacant positions and with people saving and, you know, health insurance looks like it's on track. So I'm fairly confident that we can hit that.
What are the risks to it? I mean, health insurance looks good so far, but it can blow up, as you know, in any given month with claims and so forth. But what are the risks to the $3 million surplus?
Biggest risk I see is spring enrollment. I mean, we are, and then to a lesser extent, summer enrollment. So that's, you know, we're working very, very hard on a number of initiatives that would help increase spring enrollment, as well as looking at how we're doing summer and increasing summer enrollment also.
But I think it's really a planning question, right? So the planning question would be, you've got a $2.4 million. It sounds like you figured out a way to claw back some of that. But the problem is going to be you're never going to get caught up because revenue is going to continue to decline. What I'm not hearing, though, because we don't have all the actions or initiatives in place to try to drive more revenue yet, so that means we're still going to have to address how we're going to have to save cost going forward until we kick in these incremental revenue opportunities that everybody's working on. So what we need to understand, what I need to hear is, what are we going to do about that? Because you can't sit on the 2.0, hope the 2.3 happens when it's really going to be 4.3 or 5.3. You're going to have a plan to address a broader amount of savings than what you're addressing today, because it's going to continue to decline.
I agree. I think to that point, I think what I worry more about is when we look at next year's budget, trying to get the budget base sized right for the amount of revenue we will have. And so part of that is going to be understanding what our revenue picture is going to look like next year. You know, it could be a bigger problem than 2.5 or 4.5.
Well, I'm assuming, that's my point, I'm assuming it's going to be.
Right.
So you have to assume it's going to be. So instead of, we can't wait,
right,
we need to have actions planned and some of them taking place now for that to happen.
Right. And so that's, hence the growth mindset committee and a number of those initiatives. But from the, you know, understanding the implications, we are starting to look at next year's budget already, so that as we go through even this fall before we get to spring enrollment, understanding some kind of projections on what our expenses are and what health insurance is and all of those things.
So what I'm trying to say, Walt, is forget the growth thing. To me, there has to be someone in the finance department that takes the position that we're not going to have any growth. And then look at kind of a scorched earth map that says, if there isn't going to be any growth, what the budget has to look like.
Right.
In order
for
us to get to that budget, what levers do we have to pull to make that happen? That's what I'm asking for.
And
if revenue happens because we have the growth committee and all that good stuff, that's just icing on the cake, and we'll drop more money to the bottom line. But to me, the finance department's role is looking at, this isn't going to grow, and what are we going to do about it?
I think I can add just a little bit to this, although I think Walt's answers are probably trump mine. Expense control, from what I do every day and what the budget office does every day, which is one of my departments, is extremely tight. And we have said that you cannot spend your carry forward money. And we get requests every day to spend carry forward money, because that's how people have saved for research expenditures, for startup, any number of things. And any dean in the room will tell you that we're not permitting that to be spent, or spending it on a very limited basis. We've pulled back all of the vacancy money. So everybody that's left since July 1, we've pulled those salaries back centrally. They have to go through a central committee to get authorization to fill a position. And then we only release enough money to pay for that position for the rest of the year. So in terms of expense control, without actually going back and taking an additional cut, I think we're doing everything that we can possibly do to keep costs in line relative to this budget.
Okay, but that's not my question, right? I think you're doing that. My question is
I know, yeah.
I'm sorry?
Go ahead.
So if we assume that we're going to continue to have a revenue decline, the the expense reductions you're doing right now are not going to make up for that revenue decline, because you're working towards the budget we have this year. So you have to assume that the budget's going to decline by some number next year, because you're not going to, even the growth opportunities that we're looking at are not going to take off that fast. I mean, it's going to take a while to ramp those up and for revenue to work itself in. So based on that, we have to look at what should the budget, we should be doing some pro formas, right? Some modeling on what the budget should look like next year if we have another decline in revenue.
And I've started that process, yes.
Okay, well, I have to ask you for us to be able to see that.
Yeah, we would do that. It's not in a format that is ready to present. It's in the beginning stages.
Okay.
And part of my challenge coming in is, frankly, there's never been long-range budget planning. So there is nothing in place to work with. We're starting from scratch.
That's why I'm asking.
And so my project is to do a three-year budget model, just not 1 year. And I've already scheduled time with the key administrators who can help with tuition and fees, and who can enrollment projections, and who can help with medical costs. And so all of the critical factors that roll into that budget that are going to affect it the most, those meetings are calendared, and I'm going to sit down with those people and start building that model.
Is it a model based on tiers? So if we're this short,
it would be I don't know if you want to call it interactive, but it will be a model that we can tinker with all of the variables and say, what if this happens, what if that happens? And then in real time, when we see what's happening with spring enrollment or fall enrollment, we can say, oh, we were expecting X and now I've got Y. So instead of doing a back of the napkin calculation, we can be a little bit closer in estimating.
That's great. It's great to hear. This is the first time.
Anything else on that, or shall we move on to expenditures over $500,000?
So this is a contract that requires a full board approval for Anthem. And at this point, we'd like Sherry to take over the explanation of the contract and present for your approval.
So just as a reminder, Anthem is the university's vendor partner at present and for medical plan administration as well as stop loss. And the contract does continue that relationship after a rebid process was conducted over the summer months with the use of a committee to help us inform us what our decisions should be. And as outlined, the majority of this contract is really pass-through, which is really important for the board to be aware of, that that's really the medical claims that come in as a self-insured organization for our faculty and staff, as well as the eligible dependents. The renewal itself provided favorable outcomes in administration fees, and while stop-loss insurance did increase, we were able to negotiate less than double-digit increases, and current market increases are much more than what we were able to obtain. So total fixed costs are decreasing for next year by approximately 5.3%. And I will take questions.
Where's our stop loss?
A stop loss is at 400,000.
And what was it previously?
Same. It was an evaluation.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. And actually a question either you or Mr. Fecher asked earlier, I can substantiate what John was sharing, that our high cost claims are down this year in comparison to the last 2 years. We've been tracking anything over $150,000 because I've been out doing some education with the community to help them understand how high-cost claims impact the medical plan performance. So in 2016, we were about 16 high-cost claims. Last year, as you all know, we were sitting at 22. And as of the end of September right now, we're at 7. So our high-cost claims are definitely coming down. And through the analysis that we did with our benefit broker, Horan, we determined that sitting at the same stop loss level is appropriate.
Sherry, could you just review the efforts that you go through to help educate our insurers on, the choices they make in healthcare, the whole idea that MRI and Dayton can run from $700 to $4,000, and it's the same test in how we help people understand how they can manage their own out-of-pocket costs as well as all those other things. Do you think we're really good at that, or?
Oh, I think that communication can always be better, but I can't explain to you what we're doing and what we're trying to do. So every year we do conduct open enrollment meetings where campus community members can come. Depending on the size of plan design changes, those vary from having about 7 to about 12, depending on the number that we need to have. And we always do it at Lake Campus as well as the STEM school. But we actually, about 3 years ago, purchased a tool called Castlight, which is a tool. One of our strategies was to try to help with consumerism. We have over 40% of our dependent eligible employees on Castlight, and that actually is a tool where you can go in and say your doctor says, hey, Mr. Fecher, I need you to get an x-ray, and you're in the doctor's office. You actually can look up what an x-ray would cost locally, because 9 times out of 10, your physician is going to suggest that you get the x-ray at the place that they're the most comfortable with. And so we're trying to use a tool like that to help people just ask more informed questions so that they can understand that what an x-ray might cost at Miami Valley versus what it might cost at a diagnostic lab, some other place, you know, to help us also, not only them, especially if they're in a high deductible, because that's first cost dollars, right? But also if they're on an 80-20 or a 90-10 plan to also help offset that. Another thing that we're trying to do is use other tools that, say, for example, Anthem. One of the things we're trying to do right now is to help educate people about some of the telemedicine and live health online. That is a really access to a physician 24/7. And one of our challenges right now is around ER visits. We're the number one reason that people here have seen the ER is for the common cold and flu symptoms. Now, I don't mean to disparage individuals who obviously feel they need to go to the ER, because sometimes flu symptoms are very serious, but we do need to educate the community as it relates to low-cost alternatives, such as live health online, where they could actually speak to a physician from their home via online, and then perhaps get a if it's an earache or a common cold, they can actually have prescriptions prescribed right then. So that's another tool that we're trying to really emphasize. I can tell you that we have a very high percentage, of course, in the block of business with Castlight. So the consumerism tool I mentioned earlier, we have over 40% of our workforce. And we have approximately a 76% return rate to Castlight, which is something that they measure for an ROI to see if it's really still a value. In this contract, the revised, we were earlier adopters of this consumerism tool, and since then, Castlight has become the back engine for Anthem, and so Castlight will remain, but we are going to move to something called Anthem Engage. It's the same tool, but we no longer have to pay for it separately, because now they're integrated with Anthem. So that was also part of the rebid process. Does that answer your question, Mr. Fecher?
Yeah, you know, when you're on a self-insured plan, how your insureds manage their health care can have a significant impact on costs. So that really was trying to get at.
Yeah, there are other strategies, and I know that some of the board members have asked us to look at a three-year plan, which we will be doing after we get through open enrollment this year into the next year, because I do think that we have more to do in helping people just understand plan costs, what they can do to help us control it, but also what they can do behaviorally to not get us to a high cost claim. So we have more work to do.
Thank you.
Is it a preferred provider plan?
We have two options, Mr. Fitzpatrick. We have a preferred provider, a PPO plan, but we also have a high deductible plan. We have two options.
I mean, you can have a high deductible preferred provider plan.
We do not. I'm sorry, you're like a narrow network and you're within your high deductible. We do not have that.
Okay. I mean, that's certainly one way to get people to manage their health care costs, right?
And correct.
I think a high deductible plan with an HSA component to it, where employees who will, you know, manage their healthcare costs carefully can actually benefit is a great type system, because you take the money that you would have put into the premiums and you put it into an HSA for them to manage instead, then they care a lot more about which doctor they choose and, you know, do they go to the emergency room or do they go to the, you know, clinic the next day, which, you know, the huge differences in cost.
Absolutely, and we do have a high deductible with the HSA that we added coinsurance on last year, so that once you hit your deductible, then there is a coinsurance kick-in of 10%, but we have not narrowed the network of providers, so that's something we could absolutely look at.
Yeah, I mean, I'd really like to see us move to, you know, a preferred provider plan where, you know, I mean, these Anthem, you know, they're across the entire country, right? They've got providers in every state. So no matter where you are, you can always find either a provider in plan or a provider out of plan, and you can make the choice. And if you go to provider in plan, you know, we'll pay, you know, 80-20. If you go to provider out of plan, you know, maybe we still pay 80-20, but on our pre-negotiated rate. So if you go somewhere where the rate is, you know, three times what a preferred provider would pay, that's you know, your choice, but you pay the difference, not the university. We see companies going to these plans all the time because costs are just, you know, incredible. And you know, we've got to have the consumers of healthcare sharing in this and sharing it in such a way that it really makes a difference to them. And I'm not saying we should, you know, shift the cost. I'm saying we should shift the dollars to an HSA so that they can manage that. And, you know, and they can make the choice. And if they want to go with really expensive options, then they can pay for it. And if they want to go with preferred provider options, which are fantastic under Anthem, they can have a much more balanced financial picture when it comes to medical insurance.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes,
Mr. Hoss. Yeah, I really know how insurance works, but does our insurance include retirees, or do they go into a different category, or is that part of our whole expensive health expenses?
They are not on our plan. We do not have a retiree health plan here at Wright State, because most of our faculty and staff, when they retire, use the state system. But of course, anybody who would leave would be eligible for COBRA until they elected their retirement system. Yes.
So this plan is for kicks in when? The one that we're trying to approve right here, these expenditures, is it for calendar year next year?
Yes, it is, Mr. Fitzpatrick. It's calendar year 19, so 1/1/19.
And if open enrollment's happening there, so.
Open enrollment will be November 1st. Oh, okay. Yes, starts November 1st.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, I don't think we have a lot of degrees of freedom, but, you know, the things that we talked about, you know, you can say thank you for your input, but, I mean, I really want to see them in the plan, right? I don't think we necessarily have the degrees of freedom to do that this year, but we talked about this last year also. We need to start making progress on this. I'm not really satisfied with where we are with this, quite honestly. I think we need to move it more in the direction that we've been talking about. I don't think we've moved it much at all.
I certainly think that as an organization we have moved healthcare, but I do also respect that there is lots of additional ways that we can move.
You're on a 90-10 plan, and you can go non-preferred provider. We haven't moved.
So we're on a 90-10 plan, Mr. Fitzpatrick, only with our AAUP. We are on an 80-20 and a high deductible health plan with our staff.
For all employees?
Yes.
All employees are on high deductible?
No, they're still an 80-20 option. I see what you're yeah. I think you're asking
even,
to
move
everything to
yeah.
high deductible.
There's high deductible 80-20 also, right? It's because that's what you pay after the high deductible, right?
So I will tell you that moving away from the 90-10 plan was a significant change for the organization, and moving to the out-of-pocket maximums and the high deductibles that we have on both the 80-20 and the high deductible have also been significant cost containment strategies to move the organization forward. If this board is interested in us moving to a single plan of a high deductible, we absolutely can look to move to that direction. That's a change management strategy that we need to work towards.
Yeah, I think we need to have a high deductible plan, and the cost of the high deductible plan ought to be what we pay. And if we're, so if we're having a non-high deductible plan, we'll pay the equivalent of what we would pay for the high deductible plan towards those premiums. And if people want to choose the non-high deductible plan, then they're going to pay, you know, the premium, which is going to be, you know, massive difference. That's the way corporations are doing it all over the country. And I think we need to act more like a business here in managing these.
In regards to the Anthem comment, I think Anthem is the largest employer of physicians now as far as payer goes. So I think there is merit to what Mr. Fitzpatrick is saying. In regards to flu shots, is there a campaign that this organization does regarding getting your flu shot campaign, getting your flu shot, and where you can go? Are there discounts? What sort of initiatives you have around that?
So
that
shots,
is such a huge cost.
Flu shots is a wellness initiative that we have, and actually that was this week. Due to staffing cuts, we pulled back a little bit on what our health and wellness fair looked like. However, we partnered with the College of Nursing, and for the first time, it was a student-led health fair, which I'm very proud of. I'm really proud of the students and the way they stood up. But we administered 400 flu shots, actually, this week in that one event. But we also offer flu shots on different days around the campus, as well as at the lake.
At no cost?
Yes, correct.
Okay. Great.
So this is a one-year contract with 2 1-year options on it?
It's actually a three-year contract with 2 1-year options to it.
3 year plus 2 1-year.
Yes.
Do we have the flexibility within this plan to move folks next year then on to high deductible?
Yes, we would have flexible and plan design changes every year.
Right. So basically we're just choosing them as our preferred provider.
That is correct.
Which I think
our network, yes.
And they're fantastic. They've got great negotiated rates. They've got a great network of physicians. So
I just want to speak up in this situation, because I think my role here is to kind of bring the staff voice to the table, at least that's what I understood it to be. Sherry has worked really hard, and HR has worked really hard, I think, to keep the burden shift of our healthcare costs at a minimum to staff. All of us who are in non-bargaining units are seeing a fairly significant increase this year in our healthcare costs. It's not drastic, but it's enough you're gonna notice it. You mentioned that corporate world does their insurances a different way than we do ours, but I want to make sure that everybody here is clear on the fact that corporate world also pays at a different rate than we pay. So, I mean, it's not astronomically different, but it's, you know, 10 to 15% higher than what our salaries are set at. And so as we look at this stuff, what I hear amongst the staff in conversation is it's not the one thing, it's the aggregate of all things. And so if we shift this healthcare cost over to staff that's, you know, 30% of their total salary, and their salary is already below corporate market, I just think it could be tremendous. So I want to make sure that that's at least in the conversation, that we're thinking about the burden that we are shifting off to the non-bargaining component of the university, and the fact that we're already paying them at a lower than corporate salary as it is.
Yeah, so Jerry, I'm not actually suggesting that we shift the burden. I mean, the burden is going up, right? And we all have to share in the increased burden. What I'm saying is that we shift the plan in such a way that that employees have more choice. So we shift the dollars that we save in premiums into HSA accounts so that they can manage that. And then they can make better choices about, you know, do I go to the emergency room or do I go to the clinic the next day? And, you know, if it's an emergency, for God's sakes, go to the emergency room, right? But if you have an earache and, you know, you'll be fine until morning, then just go to the clinic tomorrow. And, you know, the cost difference is massive between those two choices. And so let's put it in the hands of the employee. And if they really think they need to go, you know, if they want to go to the emergency room, even though they could go to the clinic tomorrow, and the cost difference is, you know, $1,000, let them pay it. And probably they won't, right? But let's put that choice in their hands. Because if we don't, then we end up paying 80% of that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. So with no further discussion, then I will say we need to bring this to the full board. So we have a resolution. Whereas in order for the university to conduct business on an ongoing basis and provide products and services in a timely manner, purchases must be made. And whereas these expenditures may exceed $500,000, therefore be it resolved that authorization is granted for the accompanying contracts now before the Board of Trustees to be and hereby approved. To move this resolution to the full board for approval, a motion and a second are needed. I offer this motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I'm sorry, you know what, is there another one above 500,000? I missed it. I thought there was just the one. Yeah, it's just Anthem. Yeah. And then we'll move to contracts between 250 and 500. So I think we've got a motion and a second on that. So John, or is it John that's going to talk us through the next section here?
The next section, sure. So we're moving on to the contracts below 500?
Yeah, and this is where Bonds
are. Okay, so that's where you're opening. Yeah, so this is one of the transactions under the Barnes & Noble bookstore contract, and apparently some of these individual transactions have come forward before. This particular one pertains to the program that you probably have heard about, or I know you've heard about it, called Inclusive Access, where the bookstore signs students up. They obtain the books for all their classes in advance at a significant discount, and it's provided to students on the first day of class. And for the fall semester, Barnes & Noble buys the books, provides them to the students, they bill the university for the books, the university puts that cost on the students' tuition and fee invoice. So we're collecting the revenue from the student and turning around and paying Barnes & Noble. So it's a pass-through transaction. And it is part of administering the overall bookstore contract. And so for that reason, we're requesting approval to process this transaction.
We won't add any value to the process, right?
No. Well, let me take that. Yes, we add value in that we provide the service to build the students and all of that, but it's a transactional issue.
So how does the money flow? We're paying them $450,000.
Or whatever the actual cost of the books is.
Whatever the cost of books is. So are they buying the books and then we're reimbursing them?
They buy the books, right.
Okay.
We bill the students, we collect from the students.
Got it.
And then we pay them whatever the invoiced amount is that they've already paid.
Right, okay. So if Barnes & Noble goes bankrupt in the middle of this contract, then we're only paying them for stuff they've already bought, so
right.
We're not on the hook for anything.
No.
Okay.
No.
Are we able to recover 100% of our costs back to the students?
Cost of the books, is that what you're asking?
100% of our cost back to the students. So the $450 is our cost, and you got to claw it back. You're getting it back to the students, is what you told
me.
Okay. So you're collecting 100% back?
Yes.
Okay.
Because the fee has to be paid in order to get the books.
Yes.
And if they're not in the course, then they likely have dropped or something along those lines. Okay.
And that is it for contracts between 250 and 500, correct?
Yes.
All right, so those were actually approved at this board's level, at this committee's level, rather. So whereas in order for the university to conduct business on an ongoing basis and provide products and services in a timely manner, purchases must be made. And whereas these expenditures may amount to the greater than $250,000 and less than $500,000, therefore, be it resolved that authorization is granted for the accompanying contracts now before the Finance, Audit, and Infrastructure Committee of the Board of Trustees to be and hereby are approved. I offer this motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we'll do a roll call of the committee.
Mr. Fitzpatrick?
Yes.
Mr. Langos?
Yes.
Mr.
Ms. Ramos. Motion passes unanimously.
So, did somebody second? So I'm not a committee member, I just remember.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can I second?
I didn't have a second.
I think somebody else has to say.
Is a committee member other? Second?
You have a second?
I have a second.
All right, do we need to go through the vote again, or?
I think the vote stands.
The vote stands, all right. So without objection then, we will move to the next section, which is just informative, contracts between $150,000 and $250,000.
Right, for information only, so interpreters of the deaf, providing the interpreting and captioning services for students with disabilities. This will need to be rebid next summer. And then the second contract is our outside general counsel for patent advice. And I suppose if there are more questions on that, Larry might be able to provide some information, but these are basically pro forma day-to-day contracts.
Okay. Anyone with questions on those contracts?
For the interpreters of the deaf, is that, do we have a charge to the students that use those services? Or do they invoice the students and pay the university? Or?
I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. I'm just wondering how it works with the students in regards to who pays.
You know, I'll double check that, but I personally made the assumption that that's our responsibility to provide those services.
It typically is.
Yeah.
We have to provide them.
Thank you.
Okay. And next up on the agenda, then, we have Mr. Sherbet on the investment report. It's right to your... Okay.
Good morning. So let me just be brief, and I'll start with attachment 14, which is the bar graph. And if you'll notice, for the month of September, we had a nice spike in our interest earnings, investment earnings, and that was attributed primarily to the unrealized gains that we achieved in our private equity investments. So out of the total investment income of $608,000 that you see there for the month of September, $501,000 was attributed to the two private equity investments with that. So we're doing well. Those investments continue to perform well, and we will continue to monitor to that going forward. Then if you turn to attachment 13 for the SEI report, I'll just point out again, it was mentioned that the Star Ohio continues to do well. The current annual rate for that is 2.28, so that is a strong performer, and that's where the bulk of the portfolio is at, in order to keep capital preservation in place and liquidity. And then the other item that I would point out is the down under fixed income, the SEI Jennie Mae bond fund. That was a discussion we had at our last meeting. We have liquidated that fund. That was one of the longer term funds, and there was some concern about, you know, maintaining a position in that. So we did liquidate that in early October and transferred those proceeds over to the Star Ohio account. So we've improved the liquidity there and trying to maximize our earnings in a very safe
reduce way. Our interest rate risk, yeah.
Yep.
Good.
Okay. And then the only other item is attachment 15, and again, it's just the allocation of the portfolio, and it just shows the weightings between the cash pool liquidity and the diversified pool. And again, when you see the next report for the month of October, the Jennie Mae fund will be out of there and be up on the Star Ohio line. So I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Yep, I like the fact that we've reduced our risk, and this is our rainy day fund. This is our, you know, cash on hand that we were talking about that we want to get to, you know, 90 days to 180 days, and we're not looking to make a bunch of money here. We're going to be keeping it safe, so I think it's good. Some good moves. I'd really like to be able to get out of those alternative investments. I know they're on the radar when we actually have the opportunity to do that, because those ones are more volatile for sure and not liquid. So we've discussed that many times now. So.
Right.
Any other questions or thoughts on it? Okay. Thank you.
What is the duration of the fixed income segment of our portfolio now about?
So Star Ohio, I mean, it's readily available. It's like a glorified savings account, so it's same day liquidity we can provide on that. It's made up of a composite of treasury securities, some corporate, high-grade corporate notes, repurchase agreements. There's a mix of that, but it's managed by the state treasurer's office, and it's highly liquid. For the ultra short-term fund, that duration is about half a year. It's the ultra short-term fund, and then the short-term duration fund has a duration of about 1 year, to 1 to 1.5 years. So all of those are fairly stable, and even in a rising interest rate environment, those actively managed funds are being looked at and maintained in order to minimize any losses and perform. And if you go back and look at the SEI investment report for those particular funds, you'll see that the investment earnings have performed over the past year fairly well. Even though we've been in a rising interest rate environment, there may be a month where there will be a small loss in the fund, but if you look at it tracked over the time, it's still showing positive returns.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good answer. All right, next up we have consulting and professional services contracts. So the committee has asked to see these on a regular basis, and I think John, you're gonna walk us through them.
I can do that briefly. I don't have hardly anything to add other than what's stated in the report. So the Academic Partners LLC, that contract was actually terminated, and we're paying through the contractual amounts for the students that they did recruit. And so for fiscal 18, there was a payment to them of $330,000. Research consulting services, I really don't have any additional comments on that. Greenwood, Asher, and Associates are for executive search for those positions that are listed. Horan, I'm familiar with them. They do provide employee benefit consulting and would have helped us with that Anthem contract. Noel Levitz, or Ruffalo Noel Levitz, is for high school recruiting. And so there's a contract behind that that spells out what they will do for us for juniors and seniors in high school. And then the Ohlmann Group is for marketing department to obtain professional services, and mostly my understanding is that it is in more of the online and social media space to be able to make the contact between the university and the online space to get our name out in front of the market.
So the Greenwood, Asher, and Associates, those are three positions: the provost, VP of, or I'm sorry, the dean of the vice president of research, and the dean of the college business. One position is filled. Is that correct?
It's
of those three,
yeah.
It's just the provost.
So far.
Are they actively? Are both active searches right now?
Can you answer that?
I don't know. I'll ask maybe the president.
So I believe that the provost is in the process of creating the search committees, and I understand that Greenwood Asher will be here on campus shortly.
Okay.
To talk about what are the attributes and to really get the searches going.
Are they education focused?
Greenwood Asher?
Yeah.
Yes, they're a very good search firm, as you can probably tell from what the results are from our provost search. They're very well known, particularly for research intensive universities, and that was very important in looking at the vice provost for research and innovation position that we're searching for. They work with a lot of the AAU universities and the very large public research, so they have an extensive network, particularly for the top positions at the universities, president, provost, VP research, and so on. In contracting with them this past year, we were able to get a reduced cost by agreeing to do three positions. As opposed to just one, so that ended up being less expensive for those because we're putting them all with one firm.
For the dean
I noticed a couple of the contracts have expired, academic partnerships, is that something we're gonna renew? It looks like it expired in May of last year, May of 17.
I don't believe there's any intent to renew that contract, no.
Okay, and then another one that expired is the research compliance consulting services. It expired in June, is that right?
Yes.
And that was the provost's. What is that?
I don't have the contract with me, but there is so much to do in research compliance, especially with federal grants and contracts, that any assistance that might be needed that could come from the outside.
Okay.
And I would say that there's been a large reduction of staff in, you know, the non-academic units.
Yeah.
And so we are using some consultants to fill the gaps.
Okay. And but, I mean, are we continuing that contract then? I mean, this appears to have expired.
I don't know. I'm not aware that we are.
Yeah. Okay. But just in terms of kind of the currentness of this list, we need to go back and revise that if it's still in play and we're paying on it.
So we were reporting on the payments on the contracts for fiscal 18, and as things come up during this year that require either reporting or approval, we would bring them. These are.
Yeah, I mean, I think the intention was that we have any contracts that are over 50,000, regardless of what we've paid on them so far. So if we have a new contract, it should be on the list. And the old contract has expired, so I presume we have a new contract, and I presume it's over 50,000.
Okay, so this one's on me. It's the way I've interpreted the policy that the committee made. I was reporting on a fiscal year, and so if we've renewed that contract and it didn't require reporting over 150, it would go on next year's report of those contracts over $50,000. If you want to see it more frequently than that, we can do that.
Yeah, I would. Like, you know, if we were entering into, you know, contracts in excess of 50,000.
In excess of 50. Okay.
In excess of 50. 50 is the limit, right? That's the threshold that we had set.
I don't want to belabor the meeting with this, but you know, we've got the reports of 150. I thought it started at 150.
Yeah,
was what required reporting to the committee.
You know, you've raised a good point. So we'll cover it through that piece, right?
And okay. So these are things that are over 50 that you may not have seen before, but occurred last year. So we're just telling you, hey, these things also occurred. Here's what we spent on them.
You know what? Very fair point. So I'm good with that. I mean,
yeah, this report is a requirement of the new financial governance policy.
Right.
So we go to that to see what it says. But the intent of putting it in there was, you all may remember in the past when consultants were used that the board had no awareness of.
Yeah.
Until it came out maybe in the paper. And so this report, it was designed as a control over making sure the board was aware of consulting arrangements. I can't remember off the top of my head whether it's meant to be in arrears or current or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, we can check the financial governance policy and see what it says, and we can always change it. And I'm sure whatever we ask for, you'll give us, whether it's in the policy
right.
or not.
And you know, you're right on the intent, right? That was, we were trying to make sure that we were aware of these things when we weren't always aware of them in the past. By putting the $150,000 threshold in for any contract, we've kind of covered the same thing. I still think it's good to see these
I agree.
The way that they are, but as John mentioned, I think we've got it covered through this report or the other report.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm just saying that we can find out what it says in the policy and change it, or we can just ask, I'm sure.
Yeah, right. Okay. Thank you. Yes, great.
So those contracts of 355 and 79, they're already paid and that contract is over, right? So all we're doing now is the 159.
I didn't hear the first part of the question.
I just want to know what has been paid. I mean, you've reported three different contracts here. One, two are terminated. So we can assume that those have been paid and all for 19, which is the 159 one. I think it's 159. Yeah. There we go.
The amount, let me try and answer it this way because I'm not sure which contract you're looking at. The
amount that's Ruffalo.
Oh, the Noble Levitts.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The amount that was paid to them in 18 was only $53,000. These other numbers on here are the contract amounts, so that would be the not to exceed limit.
Yes, so what I'm saying is we're only held accountable for the 159, however we pay it. The others have already been paid for and the old contracts are terminated. We're just doing the renewal.
Oh, I understand. Yes, the other contracts have been terminated because this is a renewal.
Has provided some information regarding portions of the Ruffalo Mololevitz consulting regarding the scholarship.
Yes, yeah, you're right. Okay, so that was that.
The way that scholarships were allocated.
Yeah.
And my recollection is that that provided a 5-to-1 return. So,
yes.
So what was paid Ruffalo Mololevitz, were able to recover 5 times of that amount. And so it's a significant investment and one that and that's important to continue.
Okay, thank you. So now we'll move on to the financial sustainability plan. And I think that's back to Mr. Branson.
Thank you. So I wanted to present this to the board today for a couple of reasons. This has been floating around in draft version for some time now, and I wanted to get it to the point where it was a kind of a publishable working version of the report. A number of you have seen this in various forms. What we've done at this point is take the fiscal sustainability plan and divide it into two groups of projects. The first group is we're calling priority projects, and basically as we looked through the priority projects, we would call our top 10 projects that we're really trying to work on. And there's a number of groups working on pieces of these, so there's overlaps, for instance, with the growth mindset advisory team. There is overlap. You'll see some of the same projects. So some of you who've been participating in that will also see some of the projects. Then the additional projects are things that are being worked on, but in many cases are smaller projects. And while important, we're treating those as other projects and really trying to focus on the priority ones as we go through this. So I thought what I'd do is just run through the priority projects real quick. And I've asked Amy to come and sit here because a lot of these are related to enrollment management. Paul Carney couldn't be here today, so Amy is gonna kind of stand in and try to answer questions if you have questions about priority projects related to enrollment management. So if that's okay, I'll just run through these 10 real quick. The first is a comprehensive enrollment management plan. We've talked about that for some time. That is currently under development. I will tell you that Paul has put together a list of enrollment management initiatives, and that list is 148 items long. So that is getting that is helping formulate this plan as we look into the future. Is that fair? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. The second one, which Amy is.
Just I'm sorry. So, on the first one, so if I understand the way you're doing this, there's an action to goal, mm-hmm. there's project information with those are due dates, but there's no expectation of outcome. So, if he initiated all 148 actions, what would it yield? I mean, there has to be some value placed on doing this. Have you given him a target? Does he have a target?
I've not been aware of the whole list. However, I do know some of the actions that we are taking do have a net positive ROI. For example, we're looking at all process improvement to streamline enrollment process and remove barriers. That in itself should improve enrollment. I don't know of the goals he was set with. However, what I do know is with scholarship optimization, that's one of the biggest projects that we have right now. We're looking at reducing our scholarship expenditures over the next few years as well to rein those in and also still remain competitive with our recruitment needs as well. So those in and of itself should return us net positive tuition revenue. We're looking absolutely at what scholarships are truly most viable, what our students are finding that our students can benefit from, and we still get net positive tuition revenue as well. For example, we cut two levels of scholarships just this year. We're looking at, by the middle of November, having a full recommendation of how we can continue to streamline those scholarship programs while still being competitive in the marketplace. Hopefully we can even reduce those scholarship expenses even more.
Okay, so I'm just not used to seeing we're going to do revenue enhancements, but we don't know what the possible outcomes are for them. So nobody has a target. Nobody's accountable for a dollar amount. But you may go spend money to do some of this, just by what I've read.
That's possible. I mean, we can look at adding targets to this. I mean, that's fine. I mean, I think that's probably something we should do.
Well, to me, if the project's worthwhile doing, it's worthwhile because you can generate revenue from it.
Oh, exactly.
So we should know what that possible range of revenue outcome is.
Okay.
And whether the investment's worth it or not, right?
And I would add, you know, to something that Amy pointed out, is that many of the specific projects within do have a return and an expected outcome.
Absolutely.
But we'll add that. I mean, I think that's to as part of the plan, sustainability plan.
Well, what I'm trying to do is somebody has to be accountable for it. So if somebody's accountable for the project, somebody should be accountable for the outcome and the associated metrics and tracking metrics here, right? And that should go in their personal objectives. Somebody manages it, somebody has metrics, someone's accountable for it, someone owns it and drives it, and they're accountable for the outcome. And that's in their personal objectives and why they work here. So if they don't meet those outcomes, then there's, you know, actions to be taken as a result of that. It's more than just putting it on a piece of paper. It goes from top down of how it has to work. Otherwise, well, I can put anything on a piece of paper, and if I don't achieve it, then so what? That's not what we want to drive to. We want to try to change the culture in a different direction. If I take on a project, it's assigned to me, and my team signs up for a dollar amount, it's my job to go get it. Right?
Okay, more questions on that one?
Do you want to talk about centralizing scholarships?
Sure. Part of the optimization project is aligning our foundation-funded scholarships with institutional scholarships. Instead of them being additive-type scholarships, they will begin to underwrite a portion of those scholarship programs. So take, for example, a student who receives a $4,000 scholarship. Currently, the institution is paying for that $4,000 scholarship. We're looking at ways to use our foundation funds to underwrite a portion of those scholarships so the institution can realize a net positive revenue of perhaps $2,000 of that scholarship. That's one portion of the optimization and centralization project. The other piece of that is truly to streamline our scholarship application process for those foundation scholarships as well, making those scholarships from the foundation much more accessible, so we're using less institutional funds to fund our scholarship program and more of our foundation scholarships to create an attractive financial aid package for our students. Because students see a scholarship and they'll see it's named from someone, that actually brings a little bit of prestige to our award process. So we're trying to move up that scholarship process earlier in our award process too, so we can realize less of our funding at the institutional level and use those foundation funds to maximize our awards. So when we send out a need-based award package, it is inclusive of every type of financial aid that student is eligible for, instead of getting it piecemeal. We're trying to get everything out at one time because it's more competitive that way with our peers. So it's a very large project.
Andy, we have this number from last year, and I can't remember what it is. Maybe you do. What's our net tuition yield?
What do you mean by that? Are you looking at gross or net?
If 100% is full tuition, we actually collect 70% of that, and the difference is institutional aid and scholarships and whatever it happens to be. So what's the percentage of full tuition that tuition yield?
Do you have that? I do not have that.
We had a report last year, I just can't remember what it was. Sure. My real question is it high, low, about where it should be?
So I can tell you this, I believe our discount rate to be about 24%. That's some of the data I've looked at from Ruffalo, Noel Levitz, and even institutionally. That means we're getting about 76% of our gross tuition, correct. So there you go. So we're getting about 76%. When you look at our peer institutions, we're right in line with them. We're not overspending and we're not underspending either. We're right in line with peer institutions across the state of Ohio. But if you look at us comparative to private institutions, we're extremely low. UD has a 45% discount rate. So they obviously their tuition rate is much higher than ours. So they're trying to reduce their tuition to get down close to where we're at. So comparatively speaking to true peer institutions like Cleveland State, Youngstown, and others, we are right in line with them.
But I think the point of all these projects is we, without having some of these systems in place, we would give multiple aid to one student. So they might pay, I'm just going to make these numbers up, 30% of their full tuition, and another student pays 100%. By allocating these dollars in a more strategic way, we can spread the dollars across more students and increase enrollment because of that. That's
it's
really the notion behind all this.
It's equalizing the playing field, essentially. What you want to do, instead of having 100 students paying nothing and 100 students paying something or all the freight, let's equalize it so they're all paying similar, and it's actually easier for us to budget when we know exactly what those scholarship expenses are and we know who our full ride students are comparative to students who are receiving nothing.
And by spreading the dollars more evenly across, you hope to increase enrollment.
Absolutely. And even improve quality of our students at the same time.
Well, I'd like to add that there's a few other advantages to doing this as well. What we intend to gain from this is better utilization of the endowed scholarships. So what you may have is people not being aware of these individual scholarships that are already funded, and sometimes they go unawarded, and that is not very pleasing to the donors, right? Because they're giving those dollars to be able to help students succeed. And so there's an added benefit in being able to make those connections and the donors being able to see that their funding is well utilized. Bringing this into a process that occurs much earlier can also help the academic departments by removing some of the administrative burden from that. They still have that opportunity to make the decision, but we're able to take that burden off of the academic departments as well. And the students have one place where they apply, and then they are automatically informed as to what they are eligible for. So it is a process improvement as well as a scholarship optimization project. And we would expect to be able to use, as Amy said, fewer university dollars while still meeting the needs of our students. And then that allows us to then take those dollars and invest them in ways that help increase the enrollment and capture students that we might not otherwise capture.
And if I could add one more thing onto that, Becky Cole and her staff are doing an amazing job working with our donors to improve some scholarships that we've had extreme trouble awarding. For example, the donor may have had some really stringent award criteria. We may not have students that meet that award criteria. So she and her team are working with the donors to rethink how we can use their endowed scholarships to better award for our student body instead of what may be aspirant. It's actual real data. So that's another piece of this. It's making sure that our scholarships are reflective of our student body, not an aspirant student body. Aspirations are great, but we also have to serve the students we have.
And I guess along those lines, it's just good to reiterate that unrestricted scholarship dollars are most helpful for the university, because we can use those as a way to shape the incoming class. When there's restrictions, say these are juniors and seniors in a certain program, that makes it us less able to use them as a recruiting tool.
Do the students, I don't know if either anybody knows, I guess, but do any of the students have an opportunity to sit with the donor that they were awarded? I think that's a powerful opportunity, and it might encourage more gift giving, or I don't know.
Each of the colleges try to have award receptions for their students who receive some of our foundation-based scholarships.
Into one of those.
Yeah. We also have a great reception with many of our donors one-on-one. We have some corporate donors who host receptions on campus, so they can meet their student recipients as well. So you're right, it is powerful. When our students can link who funded their scholarship, it really is powerful, not only to the donor, but for the student as well, because they can make a connection that could be a future-facing connection.
What is also helpful is when our students have that opportunity to write a thank you note to the donor. That is very effective, and I think it helps our students understand that there are many people that are invested in their success, and in the future there'll be an opportunity for them as well to help students who follow them.
You just asked, are we making sure our students are doing that?
Or at least asking,
yeah.
Informing them. I mean, some of them may not
sure.
be aware that that's an opportunity
we do.
For them to do.
For example, when you look at our campaigns, and Becky can probably address this even better than I can, but our students are handwriting postcards to our donors for the day of giving. Those postcards are already out to all donors.
They were really good.
And they were fantastic postcards. And even during the annual CSIC, the Campus Scholarship and Innovation Campaign, our students are writing thank you notes for those as well. So it's very powerful. I know as a donor myself, it's powerful to see that student's thank you come back to me.
So, you know, to the point that Bruce made earlier, it would be helpful to the committee to put numbers to what kind of these goals are. Target age to attract more students, how many more? Or, you know, how of our student body, how many of them are paying full freight versus the percent that do have some type of aid coming in? And is that the goal, to increase that number all the way down through here? What are the targets? Is really the only way to assess these, because they all sound really positive, but it's hard to tell, you know, where are we going to get the most yield, and just assess these. And it's kind of to learn too what works and what doesn't work.
Okay. So number three on the list, transfer students. We believe that, again, for those in the growth mindset advisory team, that's a project that we're looking at very hard, because we believe that's a market where we can do much better in for our students, and we will add targets to that. Four is optimized class scheduling across campus. That's a big project, because the way our class scheduling is done, but we need to make sure that students can finish on time, and that the courses that they need to retain progress in their programs are being offered. And there's a tremendous amount of coordination that has to go on between departments to make that happen.
next page, strategically increase the use of waitlists. That's something that we've got a group of folks looking at, because from an enrollment management standpoint, having waitlists for classes that are full gives us a strong indication of the demand for adding more sections to that. There's some classes we would exclude from that, but we're also looking at that one very seriously, and I've been talking to the provost about doing something that would even perhaps be effective spring semester for that. Number six, improve student retention through a targeted task force. That really, Paul, I know, is very, very involved in that one. I don't really have anything to add into that other than what's already written there to make sure that we're providing the students the best service we can in terms of advising, as well as identifying students who are in trouble that early intervention could help. And a number of universities have put systems in place to do that, and I know that's part of what they're looking at. On down that page, under operational efficiencies, perform an effectiveness and efficiency review of all programs. That's well into happening, and as we talk about adding targets to some of these projects, I think we probably can use some of those metrics coming out of the departmental effectiveness review to establish those targets. For instance, Amy in financial aid is going through and identifying what makes her department effective and what can we measure to make sure that her department is being the most effective and efficient. And so I think that will give us some guidance on targets. You know, in addition, being a financial person, I would always want to translate those into dollars, but we'll do that. And then finally, on the next page, number two, under operational efficiencies, consolidate decentralized functions and services. That's really just an ongoing project. There's a number of things listed here that we've talked about doing. If you look in the status, there's a number of things that are completed. These are all in various stages of being done, you know, and so those are very active projects underway. Same with restructure and reorganize departments. Paul is looking real hard at enrollment management. We continue to make changes in business and operations. For instance, we moved auxiliary operations out of business and finance over to facilities management because we believe that those will function very well there and are more related to that part of our business rather than business and finance. And then finally, review and optimize graduate student financial support. The one we're looking at. I would say that the initial evaluation is underway. That's a little hard to get our arms around. It's something that I think most of the campus would agree needs to be done. And so we're starting to look at that along with the graduate school to see how we can do that so that we are optimizing graduate support in the same way that Amy is talking about optimizing scholarships. So that's the priority list. I won't make comments about the others on the additional projects, but happy to answer any questions you have.
You know, some of the things I've read have suggested that universities that are growing are extensively using online courses as a mechanism for growth. Do we have a growth initiative around that?
Yes, very much so. We, in fact, are working with the College of Business to add additional sections of online MBA programs for this spring. We are starting an initiative that, in addition to that, the continuation, also starting an initiative to identify core classes so that more programs, more majors could be done completely online. And so we're going through a process of soliciting input from the deans of what they could convert to online. And then during the spring semester, we'll do those conversions and start offering those in the summer and then into the fall of next year. And part of that also then plays into if we can get more online, particularly in the summer, that helps another project that we've talked about, which is helping students get their degree in 3 years rather than 4 years.
So Sean, it was Bruce and I saw a demonstration, because there's more to it than that, of the kind of the online capabilities here at the university. I thought it was interesting. Some of the ones we saw were really, I thought, well done. I don't have a comparative. But my understanding is we have a group of five people, and they can do about 12, I think they said, online courses a year at this level of quality. But all of our online courses are not done at that level of quality. Several of them are, that there doesn't appear to be a standard or that these online classes have to adhere to. So the ones we saw, again, I thought were really good, but apparently they're not all that good. Some of them are less than that. It just struck me that if you happen to take a course that was done at that higher quality level, you'd go away thinking, wow, Wright State, what a great university. This was a terrific online experience. If you take one of the lesser ones, you might have the opposite impact. So there's more to just offering more. There's to getting the platform right and upholding a standard of what online classes should look like. Because I don't know, Bruce, if you thought the nice ones were as nice as I did. I was surprised how good they were.
Yeah, I didn't suspect that we had, I'll call it the technology to do what was done. Because we were advocating, at least I was advocating, looking at sending Mr. Woolley to, and I still advocate him to go look at some other competitive stuff, but it's very impressive. But I think to Doug's point, we could have 100 online courses, but there's no one that dictates the standard of what that online course has to look like. And that really needs to change as a policy, because if you've got this technology, which you do have, it may take a little more effort, and we may have to have more people to use that technology. Whether full-time, part-time, whatever that works out to be. But it makes the school really look impressive when you look at what that technology does when you're trying to train someone and teach someone. Then the other one looked really mundane and, you know, maybe like 1950s stuff, to be honest with you. So
I think it's absolutely critical to maintain the quality. But five people, why not 100 people focused on this? I mean, I think it's a massive opportunity. I think we could really significantly increase our investment in this space and fill those classes up.
And we had that as part of our growth committee.
And so, like, you know, again, kind of getting back to the goals, you know, what is our goal for the number of online classes that we're going to put up? What's our goal for the revenue that we're going to generate from those? I think we need to start putting some super aggressive goals out there because we've seen it, you know. We've seen other universities doing it, the ones that are growing.
And I would like to add that investment in online and attention to online is one of the tier one projects for the strategic plan, and there's already been a lot of movement toward it. What we have done in the past is develop online courses in a way that's not centralized or uniform, as people are pointing out, and there needs to be a real investment in providing that leadership and development aspects in a comprehensive way. And so that's something that is very important, and we are going to look at really from a centralized point, looking at what is the quality, what assistance can we provide? Do we invest in additional folks who help the faculty move their courses online? And having done it myself, I can tell you that it's not so simple as just posting things. And that may be some of the ones that you were saying that looked as if they were in a very passive way using the online capabilities. It's a shift in mindset into how you actually can take advantage of the online space, as opposed to just taking the sage on the stage idea and just moving it online. So
yeah, I get
so
that.
There needs to be leadership and a more centralized approach so that our faculty have the resources that they need to help them do that in a top quality way. So.
Yeah, I get that it's hard, and I'm glad that it's hard, because if you said anything else, I'd be concerned, right? It should be very hard. Another thing that's good about it being hard is it's hard for somebody else to replicate. So it's an area where if we can learn how to do it well and learn how to do it quickly, we can get a real advantage over others that are competing for the same students. But I mean, obviously it has to be of the utmost quality. Dr. Duke.
So to be clear, when we're talking about quality, there's the quality of the instruction, there's the production quality of materials. There's the question of marketing and lack of variability versus the academic content of the course. So let's use the word quality carefully, because I'm not quite certain that we're talking about the same.
I'm not talking about 1080 quality versus 720 quality, and I'm talking about the quality of the instruction and what the student learns when they complete that course.
So I can say that the faculty senate has processes in place to make certain that all of our offerings for all modalities meet accreditation standards and quality. The rigor of instruction. There's variability in the courses, as there is in face-to-face courses, but we can guarantee that our online courses meet rigorous academic standards.
I don't know. We were questioning that. I mean, the fact of the matter is what we were looking at said that one course looked mundane visually,
so we're
and how I took
quality.
It, right? The other one would make me excited to take it.
And that's why
nobody's saying that you all put together some stupid courses. We're just saying that I was excited about this one, and this one I wouldn't be very excited about it, right? So it's also how you present it to me, not just what's in it.
Understood. So since we're talking about production quality instead of the academic quality, I will note that by and large, the faculty are not necessarily well prepared for that production activity. So we've got staff through CTL that I think has been mentioned on the order of a dozen or so courses can get the full professional quality treatment per term. We could do that faster if we had more resources. We could do it slower with less. We could retrain all the faculty to have them all do that on their own. That's a different expenditure of resources. But the production quality as opposed to the academic quality, it's a different portion of that mission and requires training, personnel, and technology resources.
So I struggle with everyone's point of view here, because I think we have about 18,000 resources sitting on this campus just moseying about, you know, and no one's asked me my thoughts on our online courses. I give feedback in a survey at the end of every course, but I feel like it goes nowhere. So shout out to Dr. Kawasa, who is sitting out here currently taking his course in the survey of finance, and he does a wonderful job. So, I don't see us using students as that focus group or that customer conversation. That's missing. I think where you do see high performers is with professors who do take that feedback seriously and take that into account. So, I would encourage the university to use students in that capacity versus just relying on the resources that is given professionally.
Well, I think the reason the point was raised was because we do have the capability to do high quality production value is really the only thing we were talking about. Online courses, we have five people worth to understand in a department that can do about 12 a year. Is that an area for investment? If we had 10, I don't know about 100, Sean, but if we had more, could we
I was thinking maybe go 100 or 200,
yeah.
Not 500.
Right, but that's kind of the point is, you know, they just do, and we do have to have a standard ultimately, but, you know, we can get way deep in the weeds on this right now, but
we're back to goals and targets.
Yeah. It is, yeah, and the resources to get there, and I think we need a lot of resources to get there, because I think 12 courses a year is not what I would expect. Why not 100 courses?
That's at that production quality. They're
I think
all 100
I heard
courses.
12 per term.
Yeah. 112 that we're adding per term.
18 a year.
We're adding 18 per year.
18.
Not acceptable.
At that production quality, there are many, many courses that are offered in different modes, ranging from as little as a camera in a normal classroom that has multiple views so that people can look at the whiteboard and, you know, kind of follow along at home, which is, I would say, the lowest production quality. It's basically not an online class. It's a class that you can just take as a normal class sitting at home, to full production value. So really the question is coming up with a strategy and a goal for what we want to do for our online programs.
Yeah.
My understanding is that those folks who we do have capacity. So in part, it's helping work with the faculty and provide them with the resources that they need to be able to have that very dynamic and top quality course. And again, as I said, it takes a different approach, and so working with faculty, I think, and providing them those opportunities is key. So having a real centralized focus, which has been lacking on this campus, is very important, and that's one of the top things that we're looking at, and frankly, that investments will occur. I do want to mention something. I know that Walt had said something about the core. I think we're about a course or two shy of being able to offer the full core online.
Mm-hmm. That's fantastic.
And so we're paying a specific attention to that. And in particular, I was able to connect up the Dean of Science and Mathematics with a group that I have worked with that has sort of cracked the, has determine how best to provide remote laboratory experiences. So that's the tricky one. I think we have something online available now, but we would want to offer a wider range of opportunities for the laboratory requirements in the core. And that is if you can take that step and move forward, it really is very, very important, because one of the things you can do then is really work with those in rural communities and those in high school so that they're able to have a laboratory experience that puts them in a very competitive spot when they come to the university. So to me, that's a really exciting step that we're taking, and it's prompted by a look at how do we get the core online, and then from there, how many other undergraduate programs then will take their more junior, senior levels courses, and they don't have to worry about the core and the opportunities that students have. So that's exciting progress.
And how many courses do we have in total? Like different courses? I mean, not versions of the same course, but do we know roughly how many?
Roughly 5,000.
We have roughly 5,000 different courses. Okay, that's a bigger number than I expected. And what number do we have that are available online?
A lot of those inventory of courses that were offered once every 4 years.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it'd be a hard number to compare that way.
Yeah, that's true. And getting to the core, as you mentioned, you know, everyone has to get through the core, right? So
correct. And many of the courses are offered both face-to-face and online.
Mm-hmm. Which I would expect, right? This is an alternative for a lot of students. So for whatever reason, I mean, maybe they can't get here. Even just videotaping, you know, just the ability to time shift so that people that have, you know, unique work schedules, whatever, who couldn't necessarily make it to class, could still get the majority of that classroom experience by watching a video with multiple campuses.
Again, I think we have faculty that are doing it amazingly well, and I think students who have a really good input, and we need to utilize those resources. I don't think we are appropriating it right now.
Thank you.
I think the question that you might want to ask is, what percentage of courses that are required in our program
the percentage of courses that are required that every student has to take, what percentage of those are online, and is there a difference between the student success between face-to-face and online? But the point being, I think your point being, you know, required courses would be the place to start to make sure they're all online because they're required.
Right. So the core is nice because everyone takes core courses, but every program has required courses. The first year course for chemistry, the first year courses for finance, what have you. As we increase the percentage of those, we bring in more opportunities for students to start our programs, to transfer in from wherever, and eventually take maybe their third and fourth year courses face-to-face, where that would be the appropriate mode for those courses, or grow online in places where we can see the programs have a high percentage of online programs, but those numbers have to be tracked.
Yeah, I think you have to add into it, though, that, you know, I'd want the high percentage of courses online to drive those revenue. Two is, I'd also want the percentage of courses that make sense for people that can't get here to take a course, right? So it's, if you can't satisfy the customer need, the rest of it's all interesting. So we got to look at it from the customer, which is the student, in, not out. So it really needs to look at, if I can't get here for some reason, or I'm a part-time student, I'm working, you know, can I get a course online? What's the, you know, what's the value of that to me? And it's pretty significant.
Or do I just have a preference for online? And I think a lot of, we see a lot of that now.
It all depends on who you target, whether you're trying to get a high school kid to come to college or you're trying to get me to come to college, right? It's different.
Sure, yeah.
And that brings up an important point that I think is often overlooked. Many of our students who are on campus also tap into the online. Very often it helps them if they have scheduling conflicts or they're able to progress through their degree at a faster pace. So that's another interesting piece, that there's students who we already have, but for various reasons will tap into the online. I believe about 25% of the students will be taking an online course at any given time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we talk about our number one issue being growing revenue. And I think of all of the opportunities that we have to grow revenue, this is probably one of the biggest levers.
And that's why it's an important point coming out of the growth mindset advisory team.
But we have five
people on
it.
And also tier one on our strategic plan.
But five people on 18 courses added.
Correct. So let me reiterate that the five people do have capacity at the moment.
Well, they shouldn't.
Well,
if we gave them 100 to do, they wouldn't have the capacity.
So again, in part, it's helping provide the faculty the support that they've not had up to this point. So
right.
Yes, I agree. You know, 18 is not where we want to be, but we want to be at a place where faculty are prepared to help provide that quality experience. and that our ed tech folks can really help with the production aspects of that.
Well,
so,
it all starts with a plan, right?
Yep.
So there's a business plan that has to be drafted that comes out of whether it's the growth or it's the committee or whoever it's going to be. And then you need to say, okay, here's the strategy for it. Here's the results that we expect to have from that strategy. And then here's the actual people that are going to go do it. And then and only then should you do it, right? None of that other stuff's been done yet.
Correct.
So it's kind of all interesting, other than we know we would like to do it because it's something that we're not capitalizing on.
And that's absolutely right. But there are some things that we're jumping on initially right now to be able to have some impact as early as this spring. But the planning and that comprehensive thing has not been tackled, and that's going to take some very important conversations, and that's, you know, in particular with our faculty. So that's, I'm looking at Travis because we all know that this is missing, and we need to invest in the providing those resources so that our faculty can do the great job that we know they can do.
Well,
as
you're going to take this project too, if you don't start off. Right foot, you're going to lose those people that take that mundane class and then they don't want to come back. So I think there has to be some kind of standardization or some kind of regular, some way to make sure that the programs that are put put out there are the ones that do excite you. If you turn them off, it's very hard to recruit them back.
It is very clear that the universities that have been successful like this have centralized it and are doing it consistently.
Okay. Anything else?
Okay, Doug, good comments.
I really didn't mean the first half hour, but I guess I'm glad
it did. A great half an hour, well spent. Anything else, Walt, that you wanted to cover in the attachment 17 and 18? Or?
No. I'm happy to answer other questions, but no.
Okay. I think that concludes the agenda for today. You know, I think there's a number of things that I would kind of summarize coming out of this meeting, and those are, you know, in terms of priorities, the number one priority is to get our revenue growing, right? Because we can't cut our way to success, and you know, we don't want to get into a not virtuous cycle of cutting and then cutting more classes and then reducing revenue and having to cut some more. And I think the key, you know, part of the key to that is these revenue initiatives that we talked about and putting targets on them, including the online that we just spoke of. Second is we've got to keep our revenues in line with our expenses, and I think we've done actually a pretty amazing job of realigning those things over the last couple of years. You know, in 2016, we spent $45 million more than we brought in. If we did that today, we'd be out of business because we only have $41 million in liquid assets. So we can't let that get back out of balance, and I think the three-year plan is an important part of that, as well as continued aggressive expense management. I think we've been bold and aggressive and done a really exceptional job with expense management in this, you know, because we had to. And then third is just maintaining that liquidity. So continuing to move our investments to cash or cash equivalents. Adding the $3 million surplus that we've got planned for the year. That $3 million surplus adds four more days to our day's cash on hand. So every little bit helps. We're starting to move in the right direction. But those are the things that I would say are the priorities. I don't know, Bruce or Grace or Doug, if there's any other things that we ought to add.
That's it.
Nope.